How do you tell the difference between a short circuit and a ground fault? All right, so I had a really good question asked to me from Wayne Graham on YouTube on the How Do I Replace a Three-Way Switch video. He said, Dustin, can you make a video lesson using a chalkboard, or my whiteboard, going on the differences between a ground fault compared to a short or a short circuit? And how can a technician use his DVM or digital voltmeter to tell the difference in troubleshooting a ground fault compared to a short, because it's going to measure the same on a DVM meter in milliohms, a short circuit and a ground fault. So how does an experienced technician tell the difference? So let's go over the whiteboard and I'll talk about it. All right, so first let's talk about what a ground fault is and what a short circuit is. So a lot of times when there's a problem on a circuit and a breaker trips and it keeps tripping, somebody's gonna be like, oh, it's shorting out. Or, oh, it's a short. Or it's like a dead short, dead bolt short, direct shorts. Like, there's all these different ways that we characterize shorts, and it's largely just because people out in the field just say stuff, right? And you hear somebody else say some stuff, so you say some stuff. But there's actually some like specific words that we need to use, and it's important to use them correctly. So when we say a short circuit, what we mean is that there's a shortcut in the circuit. The power is not coming from the source going through the load like it's supposed to and getting back to the source. It's somehow found a shortcut or a short before the load. So that is a short circuit. Now, technically a ground fault can be a short circuit, but we call a ground fault a ground fault. And it's specifically because we're talking about a hot conductor that is grounded out, that it's touching a ground wire, it's touching a piece of metal. So that's an important thing to know. It helps us to troubleshoot better because we instantaneously know, oh, that's what we're talking about. That's where we need to spend our attention when we're troubleshooting and not waste all this time chasing after a whole bunch of wires that have nothing to do with the problem. So a short circuit also tells us, oh, okay, well, we know that there's a couple possibilities of what wires those could be, but a ground fault, we know there's a different problem. They can show up the same way, which is what Wayne was talking about in his question. So how do you figure out what the differences between the two are just using your multimeter out in the field? So I have a little bit easier way of doing this. He was talking about using his voltmeter, trying to read resistance values. So let's see what he's talking about first and foremost. He's essentially saying that if he took his multimeter and put it on the ohm setting, turn the multimeter on, he's saying if you take one lead and put it on one conductor and another lead, put it on another conductor, you should be able to get some kind of value out of this if there's a short circuit. So let's say that this black wire has shorted out to the white wire, right? That is not a ground fault because it has nothing to do with anything metal. It doesn't have anything to do with the ground wire. It's just a short circuit. So let's say that this wire and this wire were touching and this was no longer part of the circuit because now this is the shortcut. Current's gonna fly through here, like at such a high speed that it's gonna trip a breaker. That's what's happening at your panel is the breaker is tripping because there's way too much current flowing through and that 20 amp breaker is sensing like 180 amps or something like that, or probably far more than that. So what Wayne is saying is if you were to like find the short or you were to take these wires and test them, you're gonna have a certain resistance value because the conductors themselves have a certain amount of resistance because they're a piece of matter, you know, there's little bits and particles that make up this thing. So naturally every conductor has a certain amount of resistance to it. So if you were to hook up and try to get a resistance value from this versus if you just took this black wire and did the same thing here to the ground, he's saying that you're gonna get the same value, right? If we have a breaker and we run a black, a white, and a green out from a breaker all the way out to a load, well, there's just as much copper on the black as there is on the white and as there is on the green or the bare conductor. So you're really gonna get the same values whether you test either way, and every ground that's run out to something is running back to the neutral up at the pole, not at your panel. Well, if it's a service panel, yeah, they're gonna be touching. We always bond our neutrals and grounds together out at the service. And then up at the pole, we wanna be able to clear a fault or a short circuit, and we wanna be able to trip a breaker. So essentially these grounds and these neutrals at this surface level are kind of like the same. Don't confuse that. I'm not saying grounds and neutrals are the same. I've actually done quite a few videos on how they are not the same. But what I'm saying is the values that you're going to test are going to be the same because they're really going to the same place. So using resistance values, I don't find is an actual effective means of trying to figure this whole thing out. If you have a trip going on at an appliance and you don't know what's going on, this is how the circuit's gonna be laid out at that appliance. Now, if this is a wash machine dryer, this isn't 100% accurate, right? Like, you're not gonna be running these wires straight to the element. There's gonna be like a little board in here that's gonna have like relays out here, and it's gonna have a little bit of logic. So if this is how it was wired, current would just be always going. This thing would never turn off. It would just be constantly running. So in here, we're running wires to usually like a terminal strip, and we put the black here and the white here and the red here and the green here, you know, and then the user input is what decides which wires connect and what does what. But for the sake of like showing something, I drew it this way. So let's say that we have a short circuit, right? Inside of this piece of equipment, for some reason, the terminals burnt up and boom, the black and the white are now touching each other. Oh, you stop it. All right, so now the load is no longer a part of our circuit. We have conductors that are just touching each other. We're tripping a breaker constantly. Every time we hit that breaker, boom, boom, boom. It's like an immediate short. It could be a ground fault. How do you know it's not a ground fault? Without going over here and opening everything up, you're just standing back in the room, hitting that breaker, and you're like, damn it, it just keeps tripping. You don't. There's no way of knowing that it's just a ground fault or it's just a short circuit to neutral. You might be able to like tell through years of being able to see things trip, which if something is tripping because it's like an arc fault trip, there's usually like a little bit of a delay in the trip. If something is like a direct short, it might act differently if like the neutrals are tied into other neutrals and it's like a really, really long convoluted way for this thing to trip versus just two straight conductors, two hot conductors shorting together. If it's a 220 short, it's gonna be probably a lot more aggressive of a short than it is if it's just gonna be 120 volt short. So like as you go throughout time, you're gonna be able to see different behaviors in breakers and how long it takes one to trip. And that's kind of an indicator, but is for this situation, for a situation where you have like just a ground that's the same length as the neutral, it's the same length as the hots, you're not gonna be able to tell a difference between whether or not it's a ground fault or a short circuit. Either way, you have current in this short circuit that is going through this portion of our circuit at the speed of light, like an incredible amount of current. So that breaker over here is just gonna go boom, it's gonna pop open really quick. Same thing down here, if you have like this red and this green shorted together, it's the same thing, you can see that, right? So it's gonna clear the fault the same exact way. So what I do is I take my multimeter and I put it on the continuity setting because that's more important. I don't care how many ohms of resistance there is on any specific circuit. I would if I knew the characteristics of the circuit and what all the wires were doing and everything. If I knew, hey, I've got this really short ground wire, but this incredibly long convoluted neutral wire, then yeah, you're gonna get different resistance values and that is going to be of some value because then you can identify, oh, the one that has a whole crap load of resistance on it is the long crazy wire. The one that has a very short resistance value is the short one, you know? So there is some validity in what he's saying, but I think just a generally easier method to not have to search so much to collect data to find that information is I just use continuity. So I've got a short circuit over here, right? Let's do this again. Say for some reason, like these two wires are connected and these are not. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put my meter still on the ohm setting, but I'm not looking for a resistance value. I'm just looking for continuity. When I touch the tips of these together, that tone right there shows me that I have, you can see that, a complete loop, right? Continuity testing always gives us a complete loop. If it doesn't make a sound, then the loop's not complete. So this is a useful tool. I use this all the time for tons of different things. But what I would do is I would put one lead on black and one lead on white. And that's gonna show me whether or not I have a complete loop. And if it does, it shouldn't be the case. There shouldn't be a complete loop until like electronics kick in and you put values in and this thing starts to turn and the load's on. Of course you're gonna have continuity when the load is on, but you shouldn't have continuity before that because the load is off, the machine's shut off. So if there's still continuity in the circuit, you should be able to test anywhere. You could test back at the panel too. If you just have the panel cover off, you could go neutral to that specific breaker, the wire coming off of that one breaker. If you've got continuity, okay, well, there's a problem. If you're over at the motor itself, you could do the same thing. If there's continuity there, if there's a junction box in between somewhere, don't take the wire nuts apart, just stick your leads down in the wire nuts. And if you have continuity, there shouldn't be continuity. So you know, oh, that is where my problem is. You could do the same thing on the hots. Check the two hots if there's continuity between them. There shouldn't be continuity, again, until the load is connected going through that element, right? Because once you energize a load, this whole element here, this coil of wire, connects to both of these. And that's what allows the motor to start working. So in that moment, while it is working, you do have a complete circuit and there is going to be continuity. But when the load is not connected, you're not going to have continuity. So you can check here. If there's continuity on these two, that means you're going to have a 220 short. But you can probably tell it's a 220 short because that's like a boom! Like a lot of times you'll see sparks fly through a panel cover with a 220 short. You can see it with a 110 as well. You know, it just kind of depends on the characteristics of the circuit. But you, a lot of people that have been doing this a while can tell, like, holy crap, that was a 220 short. That was massive. So what I would do, the natural order of things, is I'm always going to check to see if it's a short circuit first. You don't have to. That's just kind of what I do. But then you would do the same thing. Just check the ground. And if there's continuity between hot and ground, there shouldn't be. That means that this whole entire thing is the green wire, right? Essentially, when you hook up an appliance or a light fixture or anything to the green wire, it makes the green wire the whole appliance. Everything metal touching this is the green wire now. So you could even touch like the casing of this thing, depending on if, you know, if the casing like is grounded. You gotta be a little bit careful in making assumptions on touching metal in appliances, because some parts of the appliance might not actually be connected to the ground. So it's always better just go straight to the conductor. But you know, go to the green conductor, go to your black, go to your next, you know, your red, go to your white. See where the continuity lies. You're probably going to get continuity between your white and your green. So don't be surprised by that if you start testing that, because again, look, they're all connected back at the end. So they're using a completed loop, you know, to complete your continuity test. So that's it. Like that, it's way easier to just use continuity and not worry about what resistance values are and what's the length of the conductor and how many ohms per foot is the certain amount of resistance or reactance of that one conductor, and go look through tables in your code book to try to figure all this stuff out. You just don't need to do that, right? Like, I'm a big fan of trying to find the easiest things to solve the problem the quickest. And a really good method that I was taught by this old school dude, Johnny, thank God I worked with you for a lot of years. he said, always find the knowns. When you're troubleshooting anything, you need to find the knowns, as many knowns as you can get, even if it's an extraneous amount of knowns that seem like it's not even important. Find as many knowns, so that way when you're sitting there in front of a problem, you can knock off silly questions, basically, because you've already checked certain things. If you walk into a situation and you're like, I know something doesn't work. Cool. That's one known. That doesn't help you though. Do you know what the amperage is when that load kicks on? Do you know if there's a short between any of the two leads? Do you know what does the short actually look like when you're out there? What is it doing at the breaker? What's it doing at the load? What's the conditions of the wire? Are they charred? Are they black? You know, there's like lots of information that you should be collecting anytime that you're troubleshooting something. And the more things that you can turn this knob and test values everywhere and write all that stuff down and know what the circuit is doing. I mean, there's a reason there's this many damn dials on these things, because there's this much information that you can try to find in a circuit. And the more things that you actually know about the circuit and what's happening, even if you gotta write it all down, the better you're gonna be able to diagnose that. Because even if you were to call your boss later and be like, hey, this thing's not working, first thing they're gonna do is start asking you questions. Like, what's the current? You know, like when you put your clamp on ammeter on, what values are you getting? Is there some kind of photocell somewhere? Is there time clock somewhere? Is there lighting control system somewhere? Did you take this apart? Is this, you know, like they're trying to figure out all of the different knowns that they would think about to try to get to narrow everything down to like the simplest point. So that's my recommendation for any of you experienced techs out there, is get rid of all the knowns, or to get rid of all of the unknowns, get as many knowns as possible and whittle your list down, and it'll usually end up focusing you in on the exact problem. All right, so hopefully that helped. There's a lot of different ways to do things in this trade, and once you start understanding how a multimeter works and what's going to happen when you do things, it's really gonna help your troubleshooting a lot, especially once you can kind of look at a circuit and understand it from like a 30,000 foot view and then zoom in. That's one thing I tell a lot of apprentices when you're troubleshooting, like you can't just be so focused in all the time and only seeing what's in front of you without thinking about everything else, or else you're gonna be missing a lot of information. So it's always really good to be able to zoom out, think about the whole circuit, zoom back in, think about the appliance, zoom back out, think about how things could be working in the circuit, zoom back in, test values, but trying to find as many knowns as you can gather is gonna help you figure out what your unknowns are. It's gonna limit the amount of unknowns that you have. So thank you guys so much for watching. Make sure that you check out our Discord server, join that if you wanna be a part of our podcast that we do every Friday, or if you're just looking for a group of electricians that like all day long have nothing better to do with their lives than talk about electrical nonsense. Check out the link in the description below. Love you crazy people, and I'll see you in the next one.